I don't think it works. Good morning. It's lovely to see you here with us today. As we start, let me read a couple of verses from Ephesians that talk about what it is to be a church. Let me read. Chapter 2, verse 19. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. These are really exciting words about God's long-term building project. This new temple that he is working on, in which you and me and everyone here are invited to be a brick and some mortar, part of what God is building and has been for 2,000 years and will continue to. A building project unlike some others that we always know will be finished, will be completed on time and in budget, that is totally in his control. It's a wonderful thing for us to be part of. So we're going to stand straight away, if we're able to, and we're going to sing together part of this excitement, part of this building project. We are the church. And there are some actions that I will try to do. The deal is here that if you try and do the actions, I'll make sure that I look more silly than you. So you're free to join in if you'd like to. But if you don't, I won't come and chase you afterwards, I promise. So just enjoy these words if actions are not your style.
Thank you.
Don't take a seat just yet. We are going to sing again about this good news. Some of you are saving your energy on the actions, which I think is a good idea. We've got a packed service, so don't worry about conserving your strength just for now. We have another song. Not about the church this time, but about the Bible. The word that we were speaking from yesterday and that James will be speaking from this morning. This word that God has spoken to us and all the things that it is, all the power that it has to build us into this church, to make change in us. This song's called It's a Light and a Hammer. Emma, are we going to have a slow verse to maybe get ourselves around the words and then have a crack at it at speed? Is that the plan? Yes, we're going to take it a little bit slower to start with because it'll get a bit faster. But it's great fun. It's great news. This is all about what the Bible is to us. Over to the band.
Open up the prison. morning. Today's reading is from Acts chapter 2, verse 42 to 47. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of the bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had things in common. And they were selling their possessions and their belongings and distributing their proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received the food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favour with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for that, Tom. That was fantastic. Brilliant. So, the band can go and sit down if they want to now because we've got a short talk.
Lovely. I'll get that out of the way.
Fantastic. So, in this week at Holiday Club, we have been learning about what is the church through the theme of Robin Hood. And it got me so excited about the concept of what is a church, what's the church look like, that actually I thought I'm going to do something a little bit off the cuff, a little bit out of the realms of a normal chat and talk. I'm going to build a church in the middle of this church. Ooh, there we go. There's a lot of audience participation, so get started now. Wonderful. So yeah, I've decided I'm going to build a church. And to do that, I'm going to need a few building blocks. I'm going to need to work out what I need to build a church. And to do that, we're going to identify bit by bit what makes a church to begin with. And then we can actually start to build it together. So when we think of a church, what do we normally think of? Do we think of a building? Perhaps we think about a place that you go for funerals or weddings, maybe. Perhaps you think of a traditional service like here at St. Alkmund's, or across the road over the road, more than that, over the hills, in St. Paul's. Do we perhaps think of a place that we go for community events as well, a group of people who organise those? Well, hands up if you've ever had some news that was so exciting to you that you just had to go and tell somebody. I certainly have. Perhaps it was the birth of a baby. Perhaps it was a grade that you were so excited, or perhaps dreading to tell your parents how well you'd done. Maybe it's something even more impressive. Maybe it's something that you've made and you want to share. Who knows? Well, today, as the same kind of excitement that you might be feeling when you're getting ready to share that news, is something that as a church we should also be doing. Now I should mention, sorry, before we get any further, I regret to have mentioned, if you want to go and take children off into creche, you're very welcome to now as well, which is just through the little door over there. Wonderful. So yeah, so this exciting news that we have, let's delve into what it actually is. Well, to start off, anybody who knows me knows how much I adore movies. I have a spreadsheet of every film I've ever watched, who I've watched it with a rating out of 50, deeply going into the stats. And so today, before we get into our passage, I'm going to set the scene for us. Really try and close your eyes, picture with me what this will look like. Jesus has just very recently died. He's risen from the dead, and he's been taken off into heaven. He's promised to send the Holy Spirit to come down on his disciples. So for the first time ever, God's Spirit is dwelling within his people. And after this has happened, this great fire that's appeared above their heads, Peter, one of Jesus' disciples, is given a talk to the people around him about this good news. Now, who knows what good news might be? What's a bit of Christianese language that we might use that means good news? Nancy? It's the gospel. Well done. Thank you very much, Nancy. Yeah, it's the gospel. And that good news from God was the final push that brought in 3,000 new believers into God's family on that day. So what is God's family? Clearly, we need to establish what that is. And we see it here in verse 42, don't we? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. The church is God's people, isn't it? But they're people who are devoted to God. But what does devotion to the apostles' instructions mean, though? What even is an apostle? These are some pretty big words. Does anyone want to have a guess? Anyone want to risk looking a little silly during today's talk? No, I don't blame you. An apostle is someone who's chosen by God to go and share God's words. These are also commonly known, especially in the New Testament stuff, as his disciples. Jesus' disciples were his apostles. So I've got a quick game for us to help us really get into the mindset of what these instructions, what following these instructions should look like. So we're going to play a quick game. We all like games, don't we? Oh, that was a grumble. It's Sunday. We like games, don't we? Oh, much better. Wonderful. So it's a very easy game for you. We're going to play a game of Simon Says. Do we all know the rules? Oh, come on. We all know the rules. Wonderful. So it's going to start off very simple. Simon Says, clap your hands. Simon Says, touch your nose. Simon Says, touch your ears. Simon Says, touch your knee. Now, any of you who just touched both of your knees got that wrong, because I only said Simon Says, touch your knee, singular. Sometimes we make the effort, don't we, to follow instructions to the best of our ability, and we can still mess up, and that's okay. But what were these instructions that the apostles were trying to follow? Were their instructions so difficult and cruel as James's quick talk on a Sunday morning? Well, we see earlier in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus had told his disciples this: "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Jesus is directing his disciples here, and more so, he's directing all of us to go and be witnesses to everyone on earth of what God has done for his people. So to be devoted is to follow what we've been told to do in this circumstances, which also includes things like the fellowship and breaking of bread and to prayer together as well. Which might sound a little bit strange to us at first, mightn't it? But why should we follow God's instructions to begin with? Well, we've set the scene. There we go. We'll skip through that bit. Wonderful. Church devoted to God, Simon Says. There we go. This is why I had should have had these printed out in front of me. Psalm 139, verses 1 to 4 says, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit, when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely." God knows best. He knows you perfectly. He's known you since before you were even born. He knows everything you're going to do before you even do it. And yet, added into that, he loves us. He adores us. He wants what's best for us, even if what might be best for us might not be what we always want. It might mean we might be grumbling. It might mean that we have to go a bit cold and hungry occasionally. But it's always what's best for us. God puts us in the right places at the right time. So if we've got someone who's looking out for us like that, who knows us perfectly, knows everything we're going to do, and loves us, we can trust that he's got a perfect plan. We can trust that if we follow his instructions, he's going to lead us down the right path. But how do we know God loves us? Well, does anybody know why we break bread to begin with? Anyone know when we break bread? Go on, Nancy. Passover, yeah, it's communion, isn't it? But when we break bread, we remember it was Christ's body broken for us, don't we? It's a reminder of that sacrifice that Jesus made for us. He sent his only son down to earth, and his body was broken for us on the cross. He sacrificed himself to pay the punishment for our sins. That's incredible. That takes an immense amount of love. I can't imagine giving my firstborn child over to be killed for a bunch of strangers I've never met, much less if they were bad people who were constantly making mistakes all the time. But then why do we pray? Well, a God who loves us this deeply wants to have a relationship with us, doesn't he? And for a relationship, it requires a bit of two-way communication, doesn't it? It requires you to also be verbalizing. And we do that through prayer. We talk to God through prayer. But it also requires us to hear what God has to say to us. And we do that through his word, don't we? When we look at the Bible. But is a church just about following rules and doing what we're told? Well, in our second little bit of this chat later, we're going to be delving into that second part of the service of what else are we doing? Are we just following rules as a church, or are we doing something a bit more? But for the meantime, I get the joy of adding our first building block on this church, which is a church has to be devoted to God. And we're going to see that if by the end of this service, we can build this into a very beautiful looking church. Wonderful. You've done really well. I think we've got Adam coming up to read us our Apostles' Creed now.
We're going to sing together in just a minute, but we are going to read the Creed first together because it's a great reminder of what it is that we're gathered here to celebrate, to believe, to encourage each other of. It's one of the great things being a church, that when we get together, we hear each other singing, we hear each other reading and praying, and everyone else's faith encourages me. Hopefully everyone else's faith encourages you. And so let's read together. Let's stand if we're able to as we read. If you agree with these words, then say them along with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Do take a seat as the band come up very briefly. I'll have you on your feet in a second, sorry. It's great, isn't it, to hear something as huge and life-changing as the gospel, sometimes squished down into a handful of almost really simple words. And it's great as well to have someone talk to us about what a church is, a word that we know we understand, we know we're part of, we know what it is, but you can talk about it for days and days. We won't, I promise, but some of these things are huge. It's great as well to hear them simple and short, isn't it? So we're going to have a simple and short song now. It might sound quite a lot like John 3:16. We might take it as a bit of a round because we're very brave. At least I feel brave. I might regret it later. But we're going to attempt this, I think, as a round because it's a lot of fun and because Emma's extremely talented and we have to kind of echo it if we can. That's not how it works, is it? Mike is going to lead this half of the room. I am going to lead this half of the room astray. And we're going to sing, For God So Loved the World. We have both the verse and the chorus on the slide, so we know what we're doing. The actions are, L is for the love that he has for me. I am the reason he died on the tree. F is for forgiveness, and now I am free. E is to enjoy being in his company. We're going to start off all together. We'll both sing the verse and the chorus, and then this half, I'm going to sing the verse again, and my half are going to have the luxury of stopping for just a second, then we'll come back in out of step. It'll be fine. Don't worry. If all else fails, just read these words. They're almost John 3:16. It's good news, even if a Muppet is at the front doing actions. So let's enjoy encouraging each other and sing. I'm deserves a round of applause, probably. For you, if not for me. Right. James is going to lead us in our prayers before he brings us another little bit of talk about what the church is. So do take a seat and let's pray together.
Excellent. Please bow your heads in prayer and follow along when we say the words on screen. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together as a church every week to come and praise you, to hear your words spoken, to be in fellowship with one another every Sunday. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for as a church family. Whether it's this building that we have, this opportunity to meet with so many of us in one place under one roof, or whether it's, Lord, the encouragements or challenges that come with being part of a family, part of a group that is pushing each other continuously closer and closer to you. Oh Lord, whether it's the joy that we get and receive from praising you on Sunday, from singing songs of worship, from reading and saying prayers together. Lord, we thank you for our children and young people. We thank you that we had the leaders and the helpers who were willing and volunteers to come over and help us run this holiday club that we got to so enjoy yesterday. Lord, we thank you for the kids that we do have, Lord, for their faith, for their continuing, growing enthusiasm and passion for understanding your word better. Lord, I also want to take time to pray for those in Ukraine, Lord. It's been a difficult year, and I pray that despite that hardship, Lord, that they know you. I pray that they can put their trust in you to continue to provide for them, to give them that safety and security that they can find in Ukraine. Lord, we thank you to those who you've inspired to open up their homes for our Ukrainian friends here in Duffield or the surrounding areas, Lord. I pray that people continue to do so, that they continue to support and look out for one another, especially our fellows from across the sea. Lord, I also want to pray for Jill's mum, who tragically passed on Tuesday. Lord, I pray that you'll be with Jill and her family now as they go through this time of mourning. But I also give thanks that her mum is now at peace and that now, just I pray, Lord, that you'll be with them, that you'll comfort their hearts and their souls. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Wonderful. We're now going to carry on saying the Lord's Prayer. So if you'll all say this together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Wonderful. So, we've just established from our last chat, we were talking about the different building blocks we need to build a church. Can people in the sort of church see our art, so see my building blocks over here? I can try and move this a bit more if you need anything, but that's fine. So we were looking at it and we decided we know that we need to have in a church people devoted to God. But is that all there is? Well, let's have a look at verses 44 to 46. Actually, Tom, do you mind if we go back to the Acts one a bit earlier in the service? Let's see if we can flick through back to our passage. There we go. Wonderful. 44 to 46. All the believers were together and have everything in common. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, ate together with glad and sincere hearts. We see that a church is not just a people devoted to God, but actually unified by him. We're going to do a very quick game. We're going to have to skip through all of this again. Bear with me. There we go. We're going to play a quick game called Hands Up. It's very simple. We're all going to start with our hands, both hands up in the air. So let's see everyone's hands high up in the air. And if you agree with a statement, I want you to put your hands down. Okay, so very start, make sure everyone's got their hands up in the sky. Wonderful. Put your hands down if you prefer dogs to cats. I want you to have a look around quickly. Even just now, we already have hands that are down. Everyone, hands back up in the air. You're going to feel like you're in an interrogation scene. Put your hands down if you prefer chocolate over ice cream. Have a look around. Again, we seem to be a bit divided, aren't we? Let's put our hands back in the air. Put your hands down if you think that the best way of relaxing is to go to the cinema over a cozy night in. Ooh, we only got a few hands down on that one. That's fine. Wonderful. You can put your hands down for now. I'm going to put them back up in a second, so don't get them too relaxed. Just shake them out. Make sure you've got some blood flowing back into them. We need those arms back up again. Right, hands back in the up in the air. As Christians here, which I'm assuming most of us are here today, but if you're not, humour me. Put your hands down if you think that Jesus didn't die for you. Have a look around. Everyone still has their hands up, don't they? Okay, keep your hands up in the air. Put your hands down if you think that Jesus wasn't the Son of God. Have a look around. Has anybody got their hands? I don't think anybody does. It's interesting that, isn't it? Let's do one more. Put your hands down if you think that God hates you. Look around again. Everyone has their hands up. Now you can put them down. Thank you. Shake them out. Get them all loosey-goosey. Wonderful. Wonderful. You see, the interesting thing there, isn't it, is that as a church, we're united by Christ, aren't we? Just regardless of our differences in our towns, our economic well-being, whether we're a girl or boy, whether we're old, young, the colour of our skin, our enjoyments, our passions, we live in a world that currently divides us. Whether it's our preferences to a dog over a cat, whether it's our preferences for movies over sitting in or even music or whatever. But despite our differences, we are all united in God. We all want the same thing. We're driven to the same goal. We all want to praise the Lord. We all want to be with him eventually. We've got that same goal. We're all together, unified on these topics. We have everything in common. We can meet together and have fellowship even more so as a result of this. Just like how the Bible talks about how we're to come together and remember Christ's sacrifice on Sundays, don't we? Okay, so we know we can add our second building block then. So we know that a church is devoted to Christ, but it's also united to Christ. I've been doing that without a microphone. That's quite impressive. Wonderful. It's also united to Christ. So we've got the foundations of our church here, don't we? So we know that a church is devoted to Christ, but it's also people following his instructions, but they're also unified by God and meeting together in regular fellowship. But what else are we doing that makes us stand out so much? Well, let's have a look at verse 46 to 47. I'm not going to go all the way back. That would be a bit ridiculous. But I'll tell you what it says. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes. Oh, thank you, Tom. They broke bread in their homes, ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. We're people meeting together in fellowship and devotion, but we're also glad and rejoicing, aren't we? Why? Well, what is the favor of all people? It's that good news. It's that gospel that Nancy very kindly reminded us of earlier. It's a people, as a people, we have broken God's rules numerous times. And the punishment of that, we know, means that we are unclean. We can't be in God's presence on our own. God is incapable of being in that place with us. So he had to rectify that. He sent down his son, his perfect son, to come and die for us. A sacrifice in our place to take our punishment for disobeying God. Jesus paid our ransom, and as a result, we're now able to be seen as being clean. We can have that relationship once more. And that's why we rejoice as Christians. We get to meet together, be thankful, because we're back in relationship with God once more. We can be certain that when Christ returns, we get to be with our Heavenly Father and experience his blessing. So as a result of this blessing, we have every right to be joyful and enjoy the devotion and the service that we do. Like children, we bring our drawings, our mucky, messy, terrible drawings up to our Heavenly Father, and he loves us for it. He thinks they're amazing. So let's bring it back to those instructions that we saw earlier in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. We're called to be witnesses, aren't we, of what Jesus has done for us? And do you think we're going to be good witnesses if we're grumbling all the time? Oh, do you think we're going to be good witnesses if we're grumbling all the time? No, excellent, there we go. I promised a bit of audience participation. No, because this news should be exciting for us. If we're not excited and happy to share it, what kind of witness is that? So I've got a quick example, a quick game for us, to show us a little bit more what that might look like, what that difference might look like. So do I have a volunteer to come and help me? Nancy and Tom, why not? Why don't you both come up for me? Wonderful. I'm going to give you two scenarios that I'm going to act out for you. Nancy, why don't you give me, I'm going to ask you to come up with an instruction, a challenge for me to do, something at the front that I can serve you with, right? You want me to scrub the floor? Okay. Right, well, we'll work with that. That's okay. So I'm going to give you two different scenarios, and you're going to tell me which you think is a better example of service, yeah? Okay, here's my first one. Oh, crumbs, guys. I am shattered. I'm so tired. I've had to do so much work with the holiday club. Oh, I can't be bothered. And now I have to come up here and do a talk? Oh. Oh, hi, Nancy. Do you need something doing? Scrub the floor? Oh, you want me to be like a servant after I've been serving you all this time? Oh, what a joke! Can't you do it? No? Oh, I mean, fine, whatever. What am I meant to scrub it with? Has someone got a brush? Thanks, Tom. Is this what you wanted? Do you feel better now? Do you feel powerful? Okay, that's your first scenario. And then we'll do a slightly different one. Oh, Nancy, thank you so much for coming up to the front. It was lovely seeing you, that you were willing to come up to the front, despite how nervous it makes you sometimes, to come and help me explain this point to our audience today. How can I help you? What can I do to serve you, to give you a proper show my appreciation? You want me to scrub the floor? Of course, absolutely. What could I use? Oh, thank you, Tom. Thank you. What a help. Yeah, absolutely. Is that what you wanted? Is that a bit better? I could do it a bit better, but I need some better tools. I'll see what I can do. This is the best I can do. Is that all right? Now, which do you think was a better version of service? Nancy, which do you think was better? The second one, understandably. Which do you think was better, audience? Second one, understandably. Thank you, you two. Can we get a round of applause for my helpers? Absolutely. As a result of this joyful service, this unity, this worship, this excitement, that's what God wants to see too. He wants to see you joyful, to be thankful, to show your appreciation for what he's done, not grumble and moan and assume bad things about him without him ever even saying anything. God brings more and more and more people into his church and his family, not because of what we do as a church, not because of our joyful service, but he does it, and we rejoice in seeing him do it, growing his church family. So to summarize us for today, I'll finish my last building block, which is we are joyfully blessed by God. There's our church building. It's all very fancy, isn't it? Wow, it's amazing what you can do at 11 o'clock on a Saturday night. So to summarize, a church is a people devoted to God, following his instructions. We're a people that are unified and united by God, meeting together, whether that's prayer or through breaking of bread. And we're a people blessed by God, worshipping him. Wonderful. So I hope that we've now got a much better idea of what a church looks like, what being part of a church should look like. We should be joyful and thankful and happy and excited to encourage and share God's wonderful news with as many as we can. Wonderful. Now, I think we're going to come up for a song. So if my band would like to come up to the front, we're going to be singing Greatest Treasure. If you'd all please stand to sing.
do take a seat. That's digging. If that was confusing, it's digging for treasure. It makes sense, honestly. Sometimes we do. I'm looking forward to the YouTube thumbnail on streaming services today, being all of us looking at James with our hands up in the air going, what's happening? But I hope you've not felt like a hostage this morning. I hope you've felt encouraged when you've gathered with your brothers and sisters, when we've been together as bricks being built together in God's great, exciting building project. I hope you've been reminded that it will be completed on time, that it will come in under budget, that God is in control. He's doing exciting work with us today, through this week, and for all of time. Let me pray as we finish our service this morning. Lord God, thank you for your word to us. Thank you that it is full of hope, that it's full of joy for us to be encouraged, for us to have strength, for us to strengthen each other. I pray that you would show us more and more how we can be bricks built together into something exciting, something long-lasting, something full of joy. Amen.